Welcome to the Becoming Superhuman podcast, where we interview extraordinary people to bring you the skills and strategies to overcome the impossible. And now, here's your host, Jonathan Levy.
This episode is brought to you by Organifi. You guys, one of the only things that every nutritional expert that we've had on the show seems to actually agree on is that we all need to eat more vegetables, eat more greens, eat organic, cut out all the processed junk. Well, who has the time, right? Who has the time to go out, do the shopping, make the salads, make the juices, make the smoothies? And that's what I love so much about Organifi. Their product is an all-organic green juice. It has all of the nutrients that you need. It tastes absolutely amazing, and it's made by wonderful people who I consider to be personal friends. And as listeners of this show, you guys can actually save 20% on your first order, and all you have to do is go to Organifi.com, that's O-R-G-A-N-I-F-I.com, and use the coupon code SUPERHUMAN at checkout. Before we get started today, I want to let you guys know that this episode is brought to you by the online course, Creating a Meaningful Life. Now, this course is the culmination of 20 years of work and research by my personal mentor and university professor, Linda Levine, and myself. Now, in it, we teach not only the skills and strategies that we've used and taught and which are being used by life coaches all over the world to create a life of fulfillment and balance. But we also go into how you can design your lifestyle, how you can improve in every aspect, all eight of the aspects that make a complete and rich life. And really, we share a lot of our wisdom. So if you've been inspired by the show, by some of the guests on here who seem to have these incredibly rich, fulfilling lives, I do encourage you to check it out. And of course, it is backed by a 30-day money-back guarantee. So to take advantage of a special coupon for listeners of this podcast, visit jle.vi/meaning. All right, here we go with the show.
Greetings, super friends, and welcome to this week's episode, which is lovingly provided to you thanks to an episode from Krimyo from Germany, who says, my priority one podcast, 5 stars. Even if I have a long list of open podcast episodes from all my subscriptions, I always listen to Becoming Superhuman podcast episodes first. It's my absolute favorite, and I love the combination of relaxed conversations and the great value it provides me with. Even if I'm short on time, I never miss an episode. Well, thank you very, very much, Krimyo, for that amazing review. And if any of you guys have not left a review yet, well, I'm looking and we only have one more week of runway. So please leave a review so that we can produce next week's episode for you guys. On to this week's episode. Today, guys, we are joined by Tony Gaskins Jr. And Tony, if you haven't already heard of him, you may very well have, is a celebrity life coach, a best-selling author, an international speaker, and a serial entrepreneur. But life wasn't always so amazing for Tony. He struggled very, very much with a lot of different things throughout his youth, as we discover. You know, he got kicked off the football team, lost his football scholarship, and found himself, like quite a few of the guests we've had on the show, dealing drugs at the age of 18. But somehow, Tony managed to turn his entire life around at 22 years old. He started publishing books, he started speaking, and fast forward, not that far ahead, Tony was invited to speak on Oprah and Tyra Banks and many other media outlets, where he started sharing his wisdom and life experience. An absolutely incredible turnaround, probably one of the fastest life turnarounds I've ever heard of. Tony talks primarily about love and relationships, but as you'll see in the episode, he has so much to share about everything, about coaching and finding the right coach, about how to prioritize certain things in your life and set standards for yourself, and everything in between. He's given this advice to NBA teams, to celebrities, and to many other incredible people, including 300 celebrities. So he is definitely someone that I enjoyed speaking to and someone that has a lot a lot of wisdom to offer. I'm sure we'll be having him back on the show because there's just so much more we could have covered. So without any further ado, allow me to present to you guys, Mr. Tony Gaskins Jr. Mr. Tony Gaskins, welcome to the show, my friend. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. I've been looking forward to the call. So Tony, for those in the audience who aren't familiar with you and your work, could you tell us a little bit about who you are, what you've been up to, what you're known for?
Today, I am a life coach, an author, and an international speaker. So by day, I may coach individuals or I'm writing a book or ghostwriting a book. And then I work with sports teams as a life coach for the teams at the college and pro level. And then I travel the country and outside of the country speaking.
Amazing. So tell me a little bit about your journey. I'm always interested, you know, because I know how I got into my journey of coaching memory and speed reading. So I'm always interested to hear the stories of how people get to a position where they're coaching others. Tell me a little bit about your background.
Well, I think my gifting, you know, comes from my father. He was kind of like a deep thinker. He always said he had mother wit, which is like a mother's wisdom, so to speak. And he would always talk to me, you know, just 20 years ahead of my time. And I started advising and speaking into the life of my friends in middle school, in high school. And I didn't think much of it because I was an athlete. You know, I was a star athlete. I was a star running back. I led the county in rushing. Basketball, I was top five in scoring in my county. We're in the largest county in Florida, and went to college on a full football scholarship and chasing the ladies and just kind of not focused. I got kicked off the team after 3 years. And when I came home, you know, I tried to work and do the work thing, but it just kind of bored me. And so I wrote my first book at 22. And it was like an advice book to young ladies, giving them, you know, insight from the male mind on why we do the things that we do. And from there, I just started pushing and promoting it. I was in and out of the street life from 18 to 23. That was a huge tug from my community, my area. It was almost like a rite of passage. Every, you know, black man, if you couldn't be an athlete, then you were a drug dealer, and we really didn't see many options beyond that. And so the last thing we wanted to do is be overworked and overpaid like our parents. So I tried all three. None of them worked out. And that's when I really just gave 100% to my gift.
Wow. Tell me a little bit about the advice for young ladies. I'm super interested in that. Where did that come from and what kind of advice was being offered there?
It was 10 questions, and it ranged from, can guys and girls be just friends, to why do black men date white women, to why do some men abuse women? I mean, so it really went there. It was pretty deep, and it was for women ages 18 to 25, and really touched on some taboo topics, some things that a lot of people are afraid to talk about. But I had no following. No one knew me, so I was, you know, I wrote it very, you know, no holds barred and just went all in. And then what I realized is women of all races, you know, read it, and women of all ages read it, and they started to ask for more insight. And so they started to come to me and say, hey, I read this, you said this, but how can I, you know, go deeper? Like, what about this? And so that is what pushed me into life coaching.
Wow. And between then and now, you've been on the Oprah Winfrey Show, Tyra Banks Show, and many, many others. So explain to me that journey. I mean, you went from, as you said, having no audience, nobody knew you. Obviously, people started to realize that you had this gift. So tell me a bit about that journey, about growing your business and your brand and your name, but also what is your superpower that allowed you to get so far so fast?
Well, I just was consistent. And I was ignorant to the world around me. So I didn't know my limitations. So I had no limitations. So I thought that I could be anything, do anything, go anywhere. And so I took my little book and I pitched it to the world as if it was the best thing since sliced bread. And I had a diamond in a brown bag. But I pitched it like it was cubic zirconia in a Tiffany's box. And so it just, you know, I pushed it every day. I used social media, Twitter first, using my gift with words. I was a poet all my life. So I would poetically write wisdom on Twitter. And it made my tweets very retweetable. And so when people were getting zero retweets, I started getting 100 and then 400 and then 800. And my page kind of went viral, you know. And my social media was after Oprah and Tyra. I got on those shows because I pitched through myself through their website every day for a long time. And then for about 2 years off and on. And then finally, I had a chapter on abuse in my book. And there was a celebrity incident with some singers, R&B artists. They had a domestic violence incident. And I wrote in as Tony Gaskins, the author of What Daddy Never Told His Little Girl. And I have a chapter on this topic. And so it was like a timely pitch. And I got the attention of the producers, and that's how I got on those shows.
Fascinating. So would it be safe to say, it appears to me that a lot of your body of work has been around love, romance, and relationships between people. Would you say that that's fair?
Yes, majority of it is love and relationships, and then a small percentage is business and entrepreneurship.
I really wish that I'd found you, you know, 6 months ago, because people who listen to the podcast knew that for many, many years I was looking for a relationship and fortunately managed to find one. But I definitely can identify with that need of people, you know, looking for the right partner, not sure if they're going about it the healthy way, if they're making mistakes or if they're doing things that are kind of cursing them to be in the same perpetuating situation.
Right.
Let me ask you this, Tony. I don't expect you to summarize what appear to be 8 books on the topic, but where can people get started? You know, if they are in this situation where they feel like either they're not in a healthy relationship or they haven't been able to get into a healthy relationship, what are some good starting points for people to start assessing the problem and then hopefully start dealing with that problem?
I wrote a book called Real Love, and it's just very, you know, simple cover, simple title. But it was my story from being broken, hurting, confused to now being happy, going on 11 years of marriage as a millennial couple, which is, you know, very rare these days.
Yep.
And I put all the insight and wisdom in there that I learned over the years that helped us make it work. And so I think the first thing that a person has to do is find different voices, different people who have different experiences and have taken the time to share those experiences so that you can learn what real love is and what it isn't, what a real relationship is and what it isn't, what a real man is and what a real woman is. And when you get all that knowledge, it really prepares you to become the person you need to become. And then attract the person you need in your life.
I really like that, because that's certainly resonated with my own experience and realizing along the way that the things that I thought I was looking for and the person that I thought I was looking for were not necessarily what I needed, what I wanted, or what I should have needed or wanted. Tell me a little bit about misconceptions. I mean, what are some of the big things that you see people doing every day where you go, wait a minute, that's not it?
Just in life in general, people don't love themselves. We don't set standards for our life. We believe that you have to play with the hand that life has dealt you. But although you're doing that, you still have to choose your mindset about the hand that life has dealt you. You still have to choose your standards, what you will and won't tolerate, what you will and won't do, who you will and won't be, who you will and won't allow into your life. And so most of us are kind of just going along to get along. And whatever job we can stumble into, we do that. Whatever relationship we can stumble into, we do that. But we don't set specific goals and set standards for life that we say, this is what I want, and I'm not accepting anything less. So we end up with mediocre lives.
So, Tony, where would you say, I mean, what's a good piece of homework? We really like to assign homework to our audience, and it doesn't necessarily have to be about love or relationships, because hopefully a lot of people in our audience will have a loving relationship. But in general, one way or another, what is some homework that you would like to assign to people in the audience, maybe so that they could start this journey, or if they are in a relationship, improve what they already have going?
What I would say is you have to remember that you're the CEO of your life. So what I like to do is take inventory of my life and sit down and write down every person in your life that you deal with, you know, on a weekly basis or a daily basis. And then right beside their name, if they're an asset or a liability. Hmm. And to find that out, you write what they bring to your life. So if they bring stress, if they bring laughter, if they bring peace, you know, identify that and then decide who needs to be promoted in your life, who needs to be demoted in your life, and who needs to be cut out of your life. And so I think that's a great piece of homework.
That's a really great one
that we have to consistently do.
Really, really good one. You know, I always say on the show and in general that I really think that we're the average of the five people we spend the most time with. And this extends, you know, to our family that we choose. You know, we all have so many cousins and so many aunts and everything, and we choose which ones to spend the most time with. But it also includes friends. It also includes romantic relationships. So I really appreciate that as a piece of advice.
Awesome.
Tony, let me ask you this. What are some of the other things that you think require coaching? I mean, we've talked a little bit on the show in the past about coaching and how should people know when to hire a coach. And I will be the first to admit that I was getting to a point in my own romantic life where I needed to reach out and I needed to talk to mentors and I needed to talk to coaches and I needed to read books. And that's really what broke me through and got me to this point that I'm in now, where I'm feeling very blessed and very satisfied and very happy. What are some other areas where you think coaching can be extremely valuable for people?
To be honest with you, in this day and age, we kind of need a coach for any area that we're looking to grow in. So, you know, I have a health and wellness coach, and he's based in Australia. I met him through a podcast interview where he interviewed me for his podcast. A real estate coach, you know, for investing, a relationship coach, a life coach, a mind coach, you know, just depending on the area you're working in. And we don't do it all at once, but each area that you address, I believe that we all need a coach in that area, because just like in sports, you have someone standing on the sideline or outside and they're looking in and they have a vantage point that you don't have, so they can see what you can't see. And then when you come to them in the break, you ask them, hey, what do you see? What changes do I need to make? And essentially, that's what a coach is. That's what a coach does. It's like a motivational friend who, you know, is helping you see what you can't see, set goals or take action to change those things, and then holding you accountable along the way. So I'm really, really big on it now. And I have four or five coaches. Don't use them all at the same time, but depending on the season in my life, I like to get advice, you know, get outside, you know, opinion before I take action.
Definitely. One thing that I always struggle with is finding coaches, because mentors, I feel like, is easier to find. But when you kind of involve the responsibility, right, a coach is taking responsibility for you on some level, even if they're not taking responsibility for your success. And so it adds this element, obviously, of finances and obviously of responsibility. So I've always struggled with, you know, how do you go about finding the right coach for the right subject at the right time for the right challenge in your life? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Mm-hmm. Me personally, very simple and kind of judgmental. I like to see that a person has done what they're teaching. So we live in a world of broke financial advisors, of, you know, single matchmakers, of out of shape fitness trainers. And so I like to see that the person has done for themselves what they are going to be teaching me. And I do my due diligence and I take my time in really vetting that person. But if you cannot implement it in your own life, then I don't trust your advice. Even though it may be good advice and it may be sound advice, if you can't implement it, then something is missing. So that's what I look at. And then you also have to look at price. Coaching is different from mentoring because coaching is a profession. Mm-hmm. So you have to make sure that the price fits you. I don't believe in spending crazy amounts of money. So I don't think I would pay anyone, unless they're a billionaire, I don't think I would pay anyone $1,000 an hour or $1,500 an hour, which I hear some people online say, oh, I charge $10,000 an hour for consulting. I would never pay a human being that. Myself, even at my level with 3 million, you know, supporters online and being a best-selling author and an international speaker, I still charge my clients as low as $150. And some people, you know, you frown upon it. But for me, you want to make sure that your coach is in it for passion as well, not just profit. And so whether it's a course that they give you because they don't have the one-on-one time or a book or a workbook, but whatever you're paying for, you just want to make sure that the price is justified based on their work, their passion, and their track record.
That's a really important distinction point, because I'm guilty of doing exactly what you said. And it's precisely for the reason that you said. Is earlier on in the business, I started getting so many coaching requests. And because of time zone differences and because, you know, my goal is to reach a million people, I don't really want to do one-on-one coaching. And it's not even a money thing. It's a passion thing that I'm not passionate about the one-on-one. I love to email with my students back and forth. I love to participate in our Facebook group. But exactly as you said, I don't have the passion for the one-on-one calls as much as I do putting out a video, sending it to 100,000 people and knowing that, you know, at least 20,000 of those people are going to watch that video and do something different today. And so the pricing of my coaching reflects that disinterest. You know, when I put on my website that I charge $500 an hour, it's exactly that. It's, you know, I really, really prefer not to do one-on-one. And this is kind of to disincentivize people to do it. And this is the amount of motivation that I would need to do it. And so it's exactly what you said. Like a lot of these coaches, you know, are they charging that much because they're worth it? Or are they charging that much because it's painful for them to sit one-on-one? And then if that's the case, well, you know, if that's Tony Robbins, maybe you should go to his seminar instead or read his book instead, where he's invested the time and the effort. I think that's a really interesting distinction.
Right, right. It is. It's key.
So, Tony, I want to give us an opportunity to go back, because we had a little disconnect on my headphones and everything like that, to go back into the subject, a little bit of love, and just ask you, you know, what are some of the things that really stand out for you over the course of the books that you've written, you know, spanning 6 years, the things that you really wish, if you could go back and talk to your 20-year-old self, you know, the womanizing football player, what would you say to 20-year-old Tony Gaskins?
I would tell myself to set standards for my life and to really have a clear-cut idea of who I want to be and who I want to be around in my life. Then I would live up to those expectations. I would become the person that I want to attract. And I didn't do that. You know, I was just living day by day and accepting what life gave me. And I have found that that's what most people do. Most people are on a mediocre job that they don't like and in a mediocre relationship that they're just gritting their teeth trying to get through. And we don't love ourselves enough and we don't set standards. But when I started loving myself and I set standards for my life, everything changed. Everything that I thought I wanted and everything that I thought I could become, that's what happened in my life. So I did the unthinkable and became the unthinkable and beat the odds just by setting real standards.
Can I ask you what some of those standards are?
Well, I wanted to earn six figures by the age of 30. I wanted to get married and not have to worry about divorce. I wanted to be able to be 100% faithful to my wife, to be monogamous in a world that really doesn't value monogamy. I wanted to have the inside and the outside. So not just financial success, but I want to be healthy in my body and healthy in my mind. And so I started setting real standards, like I don't get high, I don't get drunk, I don't gamble. You know, I'm not giving my spirit to things that will break me down or steal my focus. And so when I set those standards, everything changed in my life and I became healthy inside and out, and I changed my life. I mean, financially, emotionally, spiritually, everything went up. And now that love is transferred to our two sons, to where my son can be on the chess club, in the band, be a star soccer player, invited to Team USA, and make straight A's. When I always thought you're either going to be a straight A student or you're going to be a star athlete. And if you're a star athlete, then you're not in the band and you don't play chess. But now we're raising a son who does it all. And my wife, you know, she's a homemaker. She's the CEO of home. And when I look at her, her goal was, I want it all. That's what she said. And at first I was like, that's greedy. You know, like, what do you mean you want it all? But she wanted a faithful husband, a loving relationship, happy kids, financially stable, emotionally stable. And guess what? At 31 years old, she has it all. And so I say that to say we set the standards for what we wanted, even though life dealt us very bad cards, and we achieved it.
That's beautiful. I want to ask on two separate things that caught my attention. The first is, you touched on one of my favorite topics, which is monogamy in a world that no longer prioritizes monogamy. This is a conversation I've had twice this week already. So I want to hear your views on it, because, you know, it is trendy and there is all this kind of new thinking around the fact that human beings may not be monogamous. And yet you've set that as a goal and you've also enabled that. You've realized that goal. So tell me a little bit about your views on monogamy, whether or not it's realistic and how or why we might want to pursue it.
It is very, very realistic, and it produces the most productive human being possible. And when I say productive, I don't just mean financially and in the business world, but emotionally and spiritually. You become the best person that you can offer the world, because when you take and you give love to one person and you cultivate that love, it makes you so much better of a person, because it brings more peace, more happiness, because you have stability and you have consistency. And then you have focus, because when you are sleeping around, you are endangering yourself. So your body calculates the risk of potential unplanned pregnancies, potential STDs, potential of getting caught up in an affair, or, you know, just getting distracted and getting addicted to those things that bring pleasure. But pleasure does not lead to happiness. Pleasure leads to pain. And so I have found that I am way more productive and way more happy and way more successful by being monogamous, 100% faithful to my wife, and her doing the same with me. And that although it is human nature to be attracted to other people, we also have the mental capacity and the ability to decide that we want monogamy and that we will be faithful. And when you tell your brain what it will do just that. And it will exceed greatly in doing that.
That's really interesting, Tony. You took that in a totally different and totally interesting direction that I've never thought of it before, which is, you know, okay, maybe from an evolutionary perspective, the body wants this, and maybe genetic diversity that, but you're talking about in the modern world, it's just more productive, and you're just going to be a more realized human being if you're monogamous, if you're not wasting time seeking out, you know, multiple relationships, ostensibly, even if it's not sleeping around. I think that's a really, really interesting thing. And, you know, I do think it coincides with the fact that we've seen the industrial revolution, the digital revolution has all happened in times when monogamy has become kind of the accepted thing, you know, the last 2000 years since kind of biblical times. That's a really interesting perspective.
Yeah. I love it. And I study it. you know, daily. And I challenge myself and push myself. And I haven't really met many monogamous men, you know, like, I don't know, I probably can count on one hand. So I still see there's a lot of work to be done.
Wow.
But it is happening. Women I meet, you know, monogamous women, a dime a dozen. And a lot of times men don't believe that. They say, oh, women cheat just as much as we do. But it's not true. Because when I was a player, I got turned down every day by a woman being faithful to her boyfriend. You know, whereas how many women walk up to a man and hit on him and he turns her down because he's in a relationship, especially if he's attracted to her. You know, you just don't see that happen as often.
That's a really, really interesting perspective. And just about, you know, attuning your brain to do what you want, you know, and not succumb.
Exactly. I mean, because it wants to do what it wants to do because of how we are wired. So, you know, those things are natural. But at the end of the day, we have a choice. We have natural impulses that could be inhumane, that could be gross, that can be breaking the law. But we have to choose to do what we know is right and healthy and productive.
Brilliant. Tony, I realize we're running up on time, so I want to transition over to some rapid fire questions, if that's all right.
Totally fine.
Awesome. So I want to ask you, as a coach who's worked with so many people, what are some of the skills or strategies or techniques, things that you do to help yourself perform at the highest possible level?
Me, I pray a lot. I pray a lot because prayer for me is, I'm just centering myself, just building my confidence, you know, speaking, tapping into that spiritual world, you know, so that I can take control of my brain. And then my brain takes control of my body, my energy, my heart. So I pray like without ceasing. I pray nonstop. Every breath is a prayer. And it's just me asking, you know, for help to be strong, to be centered, to be focused, to be mindful, to be compassionate, caring, loving, understanding. That's what prepares me to be at my best.
That's a really, really good one. We hear meditation on the show a lot. We don't hear prayer, which is its, you know, very close cousin. We rarely hear that. So I appreciate you sharing that with us. I also wanted to ask you, are there any products or services, things that help you do your job that you simply couldn't live without?
My iPhone, that's really the only thing that I couldn't live without. I mean, it does everything. I mean, I have all the apps, but I could do without everything else except for my iPhone. I mean, because it just holds everything, all my emails. If I need to swipe a payment at an event, I can swipe. I can do it on my iPhone. All of the apps that I need, you know.
Favorite app?
I would have to say my favorite app is Square. Because, you know, I get to swipe payments for my books and courses. So that has really allowed me to, you know, take my business to another level. So as I'm touring the world, I can speak. But then after that, I can also sell books and products in the back of the room by using Square.
Brilliant. I really like that. That's a good one. I haven't heard that one as a favorite app yet. This is a tough question, but complete the sentence for me. Most people would be much better off if they just
love themselves more and set standards for their life.
Yes, that is a really, really good one. I like that one. I think that's going to be the quote of the episode right there. And then I also want to ask you kind of final rapid fire question here. What's one thing that you believe that other people think is crazy?
That you can do it alone. That if you aren't able to build a team and to have staff on salary or retainer, that you can build your dream alone because it's your dream and you came in the world alone. You will go in your grave alone. So some things you may have to do alone. And I think we live in this world that it makes people feel inadequate or unworthy if you don't have a team, if you don't have a mentor, if you don't have a spouse. And at the end of the day, we have to be able to trust ourselves. And so I built a multi-million-dollar business, you know, 8 companies and over 40 streams of income alone, never having a staff on salary. toured and spoke on three continents, over 10 countries, built 3 million, you know, supporters online alone, never having a staff on salary. And so I showed myself that if you don't come from an area, or if you're just not in the right circle to where you can have this team. And I've never had a mentor other than my father, you know, helping me on love and relationships, but he couldn't help me in business. When I became a millionaire, he couldn't show me the ropes, and I didn't know any millionaires who became a millionaire off of entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. So all of those things, you know, I had to just get out here and go to Google. Google was my mentor and my consultant, and free webinars, you know, free webinars, free teleseminars. I just gained nuggets of wisdom. And that's one thing that I hear so many info marketers and teachers saying that, you know, I have a big issue with, because it makes a lot of people give up on their dreams because they don't have a partner or anybody that they can work with.
Incredible. You know, I want to ask you, Tony, actually, a question that I neglected, which is, how do you learn? I mean, 8 companies, all these books that you've written, you're obviously a super learner. So are there any kind of things that maybe you do differently when it comes to learning?
I observe. I learn by shutting up and observing. And I read people. I read things. I read the world around me. And that is my book being read right in front of me. So instead of reading someone else's book, I read the world that they studied or lived in to write their book. And then I pull my analysis of what I just read with my eyes and my ears. And that's how I learn, and that's how I grow, that's how I implement things. And when I try to read books, no book impresses me more than just studying human behavior and studying life. And so every hour I analyze my life and what just transpired over the last hour, and then I pull a lesson from it and I tweet it or turn it into a quote card. And so I have over 30,000 original quotes floating around online that, you know, reach all around the world. And just from me analyzing my life experiences. And so I feel like we also have the ability to look at our struggles, look at our pain, look at our experiences, and become experts on that subject matter just by analyzing what we just went through. Whereas we've become so dependent on books. And what we don't realize is that the people who write books just lived life. They had to study and research life, mm-hmm. and then they wrote it and sold it to you. And so you take their word for it without going and doing your own research and then drawing your own conclusions to compare, add, or subtract from what you just read from their book.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Tony, that's a brilliant note to start wrapping on. You mentioned 8 businesses, so I'm not sure where to send people. Maybe you want to summarize those different businesses and let people know where they can reach out to each one of them and learn more.
Well, some of them have nothing to do, you know, with the general public. And my business to the public is just Tony Gaskins. And then behind me are different, you know, so I have a real estate investment company. I have a tech company that we're building. I have a book publishing company. I have a media company where we do events. I have a nonprofit organization that's kind of like an online church type of setup. So my businesses kind of span, but each one of them is rooted in purpose. Nothing is just for profit. Like my real estate company, we buy homes in low income areas and rent them to single mothers at a discounted rate of rent. And then we give them the month of December off so that they can go into the new year ahead and they can get gifts for their kids. And so it's not money centered. So whereas the rent should be $1,000, I make the rent $700. And we allow them to, you know, be late if they need to be late and catch up when they can. So everything I do, although I make a living, I'm chasing purpose, not profit. And when I was chasing profit, I was always losing and lacking. But when I started chasing purpose, money started chasing me. I couldn't get away from it. So my business is TonyGaskins.com. TonyGaskins.com. And it's my name on all social media outlets. And you can email in right through my website. It comes right to my phone.
Brilliant.
And I have, you know, virtual assistants that you may get a, you know, email back from, but I read every one of them.
Brilliant. Brilliant. Tony, I want to thank you so much for sharing your time and your wisdom. But before I do that, I want to ask you the last question, which is, if people can really only take away one message and carry it with them for the rest of their lives, what would you hope for that to be?
Love yourself more.
Brilliant note to end on. Tony, again, I want to thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure chatting with you, and I do hope we keep in touch.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
Take care, my friend. All right, super friends, that is all we have for you today, but I hope you guys really enjoyed the show, and I hope you learned a ton of actionable information, tips, advice that will help you go out there and overcome the impossible. If you've enjoyed the show, please take a moment to leave us a review on iTunes or Stitcher, or drop us a quick little note on the Twitter machine at Go Superhuman. Also, if you have any ideas for anyone out there who you would love to see on the show, we always love to hear your recommendations. You can submit on our website, or you can just drop us an email and let us know. That's all for today, guys. Thanks for tuning in.
Thanks for tuning in to the Becoming Superhuman podcast. For more great skills and strategies, or for links to any of the resources mentioned in this episode, visit www.becomingasuperhuman.com/podcast. We'll see you next time.